Hey, hey, I'm Lord Toby Wright, and this is My Wright Stuff News. Well, new music news. David Bowie's 2001 album Toy, which was shelved amid problems with his record label, will receive its first official release in November. I can't wait for that one. That would be good. Well, Grimes shared a new song called Love via her Instagram account this week. I wrote and produced this song this week in response to all the privacy invasion, bad press, online hate, and harassment by paparazzis I've experienced this week. She wrote that in the post caption. The track arrives 1 week after Elon Musk revealed that he and Grimes are semi-separated. Whatever the fuck that is. Whee! Anyway, the Doobie Brothers released a new album titled Liberté this week. The Doobie Brothers' 15th album was produced and co-written by John Shanks, who had previously worked with Bon Jovi, Sheryl Crow, Miley Cyrus, and many more. She Won't Live, featuring singer-songwriter Violet Orlandi, will be releasing their new single, Gritty, October 30th, on all digital outlets. You can get a sneak preview on shewon'tlive.com right now. Next up is Daniel Heerdman from My Wright Stuff episode 15. Well, his label, Lauschmieden, just released Skull's debut single, an epic soundtrack-style version of Pat Benatar's Love is a Battlefield. It's the title track and theme song to an urban fantasy audiobook series from Germany that has already sold over 500,000 copies. For more information, please visit mirlausch.de. And this song is available now on Spotify and all other streaming outlets, of course. And well, it was announced on September 30th that Dr. Dre, Eminem, Snoop Dogg, Kendrick Lamar, and many more will perform at the Super Bowl 56 halftime show. Wow, that's going to be exciting. In film news, mark your calendars for October 8th. The new James Bond film, No Time to Die, finally sees its long-delayed release. Daniel Craig, in his final film as the British agent 007, delivers what critics call one of the best films in the franchise. And in TV news, Netflix premieres the entire Seinfeld series this week. And also arriving on the platform is the much-anticipated Diana, the musical, the live-filmed Broadway play based on the late Princess of Wales's life. And in Formula One, October 10th is the Turkish Grand Prix at Istanbul Park. Only 2 points separate Hamilton and Verstappen in a very heated battle for the World Driver Championship. Don't miss that one. It's going to be good. And one more, in the world of audio gear. Imperative Audio have launched the PVB Portable Vocal Booth, designed to provide recording solutions perfect for those working at home or who may not have access to a treated studio space. The cylindrical shape comes with acoustically treated internal walls that can be assembled and disassembled in a couple of minutes. With 5 retractable legs, the booth is also handy as an ISO booth for guitar amplifiers. Easily collapsible and lightweight, the booth is very easy to transport or store. And those are some of the headlines this week on My Wright Stuff News. And back to you, Toby. Hey, hey, and welcome back to My Wright Stuff, which is a film, TV, sports, music, adventure, and inspirational lifestyle podcast. I'm your host, Lord Toby Wright. Well, this week we have a very, very special update featuring our newly crowned National Auto Sport Association National Champion, Joey Dumas. He won at Daytona the week of September 19th, and Joey was My Wright Stuff's episode 12, which we will re-air after our exclusive update on his win. So let's hear from our new national champion, Joey Dumas. Welcome. How are you, brother?
Doing great, man. Thanks again for having me.
You bet.
This past few weeks have just been absolutely amazing. We went down to Daytona and practice on Thursday. We had the pole on Friday afternoon, so we felt good going into the weekend. And I had one of my fellow veterans, and he got second place. I think he was second on the starting grid, He came in and Duncan Connor is his name. And he got first place right off the bat on Saturday. And then we had two more on Saturday and two on Sunday, which I got first place in all of those. And at the end of the day, after Sunday evening, we all got called up to the podium. Duncan was right there on my right-hand side, and they gave me one of these.
Whoa, what is that?
That is our national championship trophy.
Oh, that is sweet, dude. Congratulations.
So, well, I appreciate it, you know, but it's a team effort. We had lots of folks there. We had, you know, Persist Group, Ed Lake and his crew came in. We had dinners. They brought Gatorades and everything, waters and stuff to rehydrate. And we had the, you know, EBM group, Todd McCain, Michael Spellmeyer, you know, Porsche Mobile was viewing it back home. They couldn't make it.
Great.
They had their open house. One of my partners in Settle My Case, Bobby Gill, came. And, of course, virtually you guys were there because you were watching. And we were glad to have My Wright Stuff and F3 Entertainment there. And, man, it was just phenomenal. You know, it's phenomenal that a small-town Alabama boy from Citronelle, Alabama, can actually be the national champion for, you know, National Auto Sport Association. Just unbelievable. We had people
that
there
is
from,
fantastic.
You know, from California to, you know, to Florida, all over the country. So
that's great.
Yeah. Super, super happy.
Congratulations. I know, man, like I learned how to drive a Daytona and that's kind of weird, but I know it's a crazy track and it's half oval, it's half road course. And how's that track different from the others in your series?
Oh, it's, you know, insanely challenging in a lot of ways, because you have to either reduce your aero so that you're faster on the outside, or increase your aero so that you're faster on the inside. Now, my car, I was slower on the outside than a lot of my competitors in my class, because we had increased the aero so that our stronger game was on the infield. We'd done all the calculations and math and stuff to figure out what's going to result in, you know, the best overall lap. And so we went with the inside game, and man, my buddy Michael Jordan Automotive in Daphne, Alabama, had my car set up perfectly.
I
literally would not change anything. We made some changes right at the very end, but it didn't really, you know, we changed the aero in the back a little bit. But it didn't really make a difference. Where we won was in having the added aero and really picking up our game on the infield. Of course, you know, with that, you have to take chances. But, you know, we took chances. We didn't, but they were calculated chances. One is going flat out through what's called the kink, and it's a curve, you know, and really, I was a little timid about going flat-footed, as we call it, which is full throttle, no slowing down, and making that curve and still being not having enough room to track out so you don't go off track. So that's the risk that you're running. So we eased up to that and got to where I was flat-footing all the way through it, and it made the difference. That's
really fantastic.
Important. And that was that was a pointer that that Duncan had shared with me previously a couple months ago at Daytona. He said, "Man, you need to try to flat foot that because you'll save some time." And so,
how much did it save you?
You know, it probably saved me, you know, several tenths,
two or three tenths,
right there. Yeah, probably so.
And, yeah, probably two or three, I would say.
Yeah, I'll let, you know, my buddy Mike Jordan, he kind of helps me calculate all that sort of stuff. And so he said, yeah, you know, you can do it and it'll make a significant difference. And it would. And I changed up some on turn one, my approach on that. And one time I was on track, and you'll love this because I know you like the prototypes from Johnny O.
That's right.
We had a bunch of prototypes on the track with us, you know, and they're much faster. And I come into turn one, and you know how you come off the high banks, you're going really fast, and you look up and you see five prototypes coming at you. And so they met up with me right before and as I was going through turn one, and they just, man, they just, oh God, they're so fast.
Oh, they are.
Insanely fast.
And their braking is sick, right? Like, you know, they'll go from 100 to zero in, you know, what, 180 feet or something like that. It's like ridiculously fast. And the G-forces that those guys feel when they hit the brakes that hard, you know, it's unbelievable. Like, you know, and they do it time after time after time again. And exactly the same spot every time. And exactly the same,
My brake game is pretty strong as well. It's...
You're a late breaker.
Yeah. And, you know, Porsche is pretty well known for their ability to late brake.
Right.
And I don't know the engineering aspects of whether that's because the rear engine is back there, you know, providing that or really what the difference is. But I know that, man, I can stop really well. So the late braking helps me make up some time as well. When other cars, you know, having a brake earlier.
Right, exactly. You have to.
Like coming into the, you know, coming into the bus stop on the outside, you know, there was a lot of cars, they would start braking at the two marker. Well, I would lift at the two marker in about 1.5, I would hit the brakes really hard and then release and go, you know, go into the bus stop. And I got the bus stop nailed. You know, I was coming out of the bus stop probably, you know, doing close to 90. Which is fast.
Oh, that's great.
What you want that momentum coming out because it helps you, you know, going around the outside.
So, right. Well,
yeah, we had a great strategy. And it was fantastic having a lot of good friends. My hometown folks were, you know, watching back home and had friends flying in from everywhere. And it was fantastic.
That's fabulous. Well, congratulations once again. What's next for our national champion besides my hot laps, of course?
Well, there are some things that we are working on now.
Okay.
That is too much that I can't really go into the details now until we get them all ironed out. But we are talking to some major sponsors. And, you know, everybody that knows me knows I'm a super loyal guy. So I can tell you this. When we get everything nailed down, I would love for you to be a part of the announcement and announcing to the world what's going on.
I would love to.
Pull everything together and everything works out like we're planning, then it'll be, you know, new car, new series. That's about all the hints I can give you.
Okay.
So, you know, we don't know if it'll happen. You know, there's a lot of things that has to come into play for that to happen. But if it happens, I would absolutely love for you to be in on making that announcement.
I would love to. Thank you very much. I appreciate that opportunity.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll keep you posted, man.
Thank you. Well, now let's revisit episode 12, featuring our newly crowned champion, Joey Dumas. This episode is brought to you by our good friends at the Persist Group. Stay tuned to the end of this episode for your chance to win a My Wright Stuff Persist Group Race Team t-shirt.
It's My Wright Stuff with your host, Grammy Award-winning record producer and inventor, Toby Wright. Is brought to you by Taummhoms, a natural sleep and sound healing portal available globally at www.taummhoms.com. That's www.taummhoms.com.
I'm your announcer, Grinnin' Barrett. Here's Toby.
Well, hey, welcome back to My Wright Stuff, which is a film, TV, sports, and adventure lifestyle podcast. and our guests come from all walks of life and not just the music sector. I'm your host, Lord Toby Wright, and on today's podcast, I have a very special guest. His name is Mr. Joey Dumas. But first, I want to thank our sponsor, Taummhoms, which is a natural sleep and sound healing portal, helping people globally to get to sleep faster and stay asleep longer through www.taummhoms.com. That's www.taummhoms.com. And most of all, a big thank you to all of you who stream, download, watch, and support My Wright Stuff. Keep spreading the word, and be sure to click on our show notes below. Follow our link tree for a full list of all the channels we're streaming on, as well as all of our sites, social media platforms. Also, if you're able, please follow our support link to donate to My Wright Stuff. Every single dollar helps support My Wright Stuff crew who make this all possible. And of course, subscribe to our YouTube channel, as well as the podcast channel of your choice, so you never miss a single episode. Please head on over to My Wright Stuff and go to the store tab and pick up some snazzy merch for those bodies, which I'll probably show you at the end of the show. Anyway, let's have a big My Wright Stuff warm welcome for Mr. Joey Dumas. Joey, how are you today?
Doing great, man. How about you?
I'm doing great. It feels good today to be alive. I was sick a little bit last week, and you know, but I feel a heck of a lot better today.
Well, you look a lot. You look fantastic. It's a great weekend. Weather is weather's super nice here, man. I know the West Coast is scorching right now, but down here the temperatures are really mild. Fantastic.
That's beautiful. Yeah, they're kind of mild out here too. I live kind of like 10 miles from the coast, so I get all that nice warm sea air, which is beautiful. Better than living in the desert, right?
Absolutely. Well, you know, I'm directly on the Gulf of Mexico. I look out my balcony or my living room, I see water.
Oh, that's awesome. I love it.
Yeah, it's great.
Well, for those of you who don't know, Joey Dumas is a lawyer, a race car driver, and a high-performance driving instructor, and he drives in the NASA series, which is the National Auto Sport Association series, with his Porsche team. And I have lots to unpack today with our distinguished guest, but if anyone is in the pole position to do it, it's this man. All right, well, under starter's orders, I now introduce you officially to Mr. Joey Dumas. How are you, sir?
Again. Doing great, man. Fantastic.
That's good. Well, let's get right into this. I'd love to know some more about you, and I'm sure that our listening audience would love to as well. And so I understand you began your career initially in the military. So what, if anything, can you tell us about that?
Yeah, sure. I guess my real point in life that I started contributing to society was when I went in the military, and that was kind of right after high school. I grew up in a small town just north of Mobile, Alabama, called Citronelle, Alabama.
Okay.
And it's a really small town, and it's not a whole lot of industry or opportunities there, you know, not enough to fulfill the population anyhow, even though it's a small town. So, most of my family worked in the oil industry or in the chemical business or something, and you know, I just had to do something else. So I went and joined the Air Force, spent some time in training and all that in San Antonio and Wichita Falls, Texas. Eventually was stationed in New Jersey and at McGuire Air Force Base, which is at the time was a fantastic place. I wasn't far from New York City and wasn't far from Philly.
Great.
Or the boardwalk. And I was stationed there, spent all of my military time there, except for a short stint I did in the Middle East.
That's beautiful. Well, I just want to thank you for your service, sir.
Thank you.
And that's very important to me to thank all those who do go over and serve. And I understand from there you went into law enforcement. And was that a natural switch after the services?
Well, you know, I was when I got back out, I had a similar problem as to the one whenever I went in, which was not a whole lot of job opportunities. I started looking for something to do. And I had an uncle that lived in Jackson, Mississippi, that had a business painting houses and and apartments and things like that. And so I went to work with him temporarily. And it didn't take me long. Every single day, I would say, was motivation to find something else to do. That just wasn't for me. And anyhow, I seen an ad in the paper, and where they were hiring police officers, the city of Ridgeland, Mississippi, which is a suburb of Jackson. I had an interest in the law from the time I was 16, and I said, well, this is kind of law related, so let's go.
Sure.
And so I applied, got hired as a patrol officer, and worked on patrol for a while. Still to this day, I'm really good friends with a lot of the guys that I worked with then. I had an interest in drug enforcement. There was an opportunity back closer to home in Mobile, Alabama, or Citronelle area. Right. And I took it and went down and worked on a drug task force, and ended up doing a lot of interesting stuff in drug enforcement, a lot of undercover work, a lot of busting higher level dealers, gangs, things of that nature, and worked with a lot of local, state, and federal law enforcement, and friends with all those guys still today.
That's fantastic. After that, you went into law school, right? Is that something you always wanted to do, or?
Well, not right after that. I'd gotten married and had a child during the course of my law enforcement career and stuff. And law enforcement's really, really tough on a marriage. And I got out of law enforcement and went to work for some lawyers all throughout the country doing investigative work for plaintiff law firms. And so that was closer to the law, the type of law that, you know, that I was really had an interest in.
Right.
And so I did that for a while. And then a buddy of mine that worked with me, who I'd been friends with for years and years and years, I mean, a long time. And he came over and he said, man, I'm thinking about going to law school. And he said, we've always talked about wanting to go to law school. Why don't we go together? I said, Joe, I've got a kid in college, you know, I've got a house, I've got debt, I've got, you know, all these nice cars. I've got more than I ever thought I'd have in my life. And he said, yeah, but you always want to be a lawyer. And I said, yeah, you know, that's true. And he said, you don't live but once. So my wife got on board with it completely. She supported me and said, you know, that's all I've ever heard since we met. So you want to be a lawyer. And she said, you're not getting any younger. So I had some undergrad to finish up, which I finished up.
Okay.
And while doing that, applied for law school, and I started law school at 40.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah, here's a really funny story I'll tell you if that's okay.
Sure, of course it's okay.
What's funny is, you know, they consider a young lawyer a person practicing 10 years or less, right?
Okay.
It's not determined by age.
Right.
Because I went through law school, started at 40, through law school, and after I had been practicing 9 years, that was 2019, the dean of our law school called me and told me she had named me as the 2019 Young Lawyer of the Year.
That's excellent.
53 years old, Toby.
Right.
It was
beautiful.
Was funny when I got up to give my speech. Obviously, you know, I'm a guy who likes to joke and cut up. So
sure.
We had a lot of fun with that.
Right. So, well, that seemed to spiral into, you know, you're doing extremely well, winning lots of accolades, including serving as a two-term president of the American Association for Justice student chapter, serving on the board of governors for the Mississippi Association for Justice student chapter, and made the dean's list. Was awarded the best opening statement, placed second in his trial practice class. See, like it just seems like, you know, you have those very high expectations of yourself. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Man, I'm one of those guys that when I do something, I am just relentless towards it.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I had, I went to Mississippi College School of Law. I have to shout out to my law school there. Fantastic, fantastic law school. I'm very close to the dean, the former dean, my professors. They're just phenomenal. You know, I had guys that teach me that, you know, they graduated from Harvard and Yale and, you know, the best schools in the country. Bottom line is they learn out of the same books as we did.
That's
and
right.
So we had great folks. But back to, I'm just like super, super, super driven. I had a tough childhood. And there was a lot of naysayers along the way, man. And so fortunately, I have some really good people I looked up to that encouraged me. My wife is one of them. I'm just through the roof driven. I tell everybody, I think I'm average intelligence, but I'm through the roof with drive, determination, and loyalty.
Perfect. You know, so you have your own law firm, right?
And I do. I went to work right out of law school. Some of the guys that I'd worked with before when I was doing investigative work had a firm, and they wanted me to go to work for them. So after law school, I did. We had an office in Alabama, and we had one in Manhattan Beach, California.
Oh, wow.
And so I worked with them and kind of in my investigative realm before I went to law school. Everything had kind of migrated towards pharmaceutical litigation. So I investigated the first Vioxx case that went to trial. So I knew whenever I was one of the exceptions in law school and that I knew exactly what I wanted to do whenever I got out. You know, of course, some of that is being older in age. Right. So when I got out, I went to work for them, and one of the partners who I was very close friends with, a gentleman by the name of Paul Sizemore, he was kind of my mentor and guide, you know, while I was an investigator. He's one of the ones that really encouraged me to go to law school as well. He was killed. He was over the Manhattan Beach office. He was killed in a whitewater rafting accident.
Oh, man.
And things were just never really the same after that. You know, I was completely devastated, as you can imagine. And so things just were really never the same after that. So I love the beach. I live on the Gulf of Mexico.
Right.
We had at that time experienced the BP oil spill.
Kind
of was detrimental to our local economy and our beaches. And it impacted a lot of my friends personally with their businesses and livelihoods. And so, you know, I went and said, I'm just going to start my own firm. And so I left, you know, and I did the normal go down to the courthouse and represent DUIs and drug charges and stuff like that some as well, just for a cash revenue source and you know, to get some court time experience. But I was really jumped into the BP litigation, representing businesses who had suffered economic losses.
Excellent.
And so I devoted a whole lot of time with that. And then I was able to get a lot of other law firms to send my group their cases for us to work with, for us all to collectively work on. So it was a joint effort amongst a bunch of different firms. But I was able to do that because people knew my reputation of having integrity and working really hard, and they knew they could trust me.
Right.
So the law firms did, and the friends that I represented with their businesses. I mean, you know, a lot of them, particularly friends I grew up with, they've known me all of their lives, you know. So it was very rewarding in a lot of ways. Everything that I get involved in is because most of the time it's something that's touched me personally or someone that I know. I'm just not I have to be, I kind of have to really be into it to really get in. I get bored really easy. And so I have to be passionate about something. But if I'm passionate about something, I'm relentless, which is where we were leading to earlier.
Right.
Man, I'm just relentless. I just don't give up. I think I'm average intelligence, but I'm through the roof with
determination. The Persist Group of Companies understands the unique needs of the legal industry, offering a variety of services, including mass tort case acquisition, omni-channel communication software, and even book publishing. The Persist Group can address the pain points felt by those involved in legal services. The Persist Group of Companies includes leaders in mass torts. Leadersinmasstorts.com for case acquisition services. Persist Software at forpersist.com for your omni-channel communication needs. And Game Changer Publishing at gamechangerpublishing.com. Persist Software, designed to maximize employee productivity in any industry. Contact us today to learn more at forpersist.com. That's forpersist.com. I love that, man.
It's the only way, you know. I mean, like I said, I had a really tough childhood, and if I hadn't have had those traits or developed those traits, then I wouldn't have made it. I would have been another statistic.
You wouldn't even approached half the things you've done in your life, you know?
Right.
I'm the same way, you know, just relentless about things that I'm passionate about. Right. Yeah. So that's how we all climb up, I think, in, you know, the ladder of our love and our lives, you know, is that passion, and we just keep going. So,
yes. And you have a huge heart, which is one thing that I really, really admire about you. Obviously,
well, thank you.
In addition to your work stuff, which it's so bizarre that, you know, it was like we became friends, and then I see after the fact, it was like everything I listened to you've worked on pretty much. You know, it's like, oh my gosh, I can't believe
sorry.
It's so bizarre how people get brought together in this.
It really is.
Reasons, you know.
That's right.
And so.
Well, speaking of which, you know, I know it's important to find like-minded people that you work with, right? And I find it useful. And, I know we had a mutual friend who unfortunately passed away, but I understand you and he had a record label. And can you tell us about that relationship and that label and that kind of stuff?
Yeah, it's the relationship, I think, is the very most important thing.
Absolutely.
Because, you know, I mean, I have friends that are musicians, and I like them. I like their music.
Sure.
But if I really like them as a person, if they're a good human, then I'm just really, really, that's what means the most to me. You know?
A bit more driven, right?
So I got to know Matt through the most bizarrest of ways. Ironically, I figured you'd want to talk about Matt. So we're actually in my condo, Matt has a bedroom.
And, excellent.
And I didn't tell you in advance, but I knew that you had produced their some of their music.
Yeah, and, actually, I mixed A Better Life, which is their first record. And so our audience knows who we're talking about. We're talking about Matt Roberts from Three Doors Down, an original member. Yeah. And I mixed their first record, which has the song Kryptonite on it. If you're not familiar with their catalog, please go check out Three Doors Down. And absolutely. So anyway, please continue. I'm sorry.
So I knew that you'd done some work on their album. And I said, you know, Toby and I was going to sit down and I kind of want to make this special for you and my own way. And so this is Matt's bedroom that we're actually in right now.
Oh, wow.
I decorated it up, and he would spend, he'd come over here a bunch. He could get away and just be Matt.
Right.
So we a lot of great memories with Matt here at our home. He's friends with me and my wife, very, very close with my wife as well.
Absolutely. Great.
So I met Matt originally. I had bought a Mercedes at the Porsche dealer. I'm Porsche on the brand now. At the Mercedes dealer in Mobile. And ironically, that is the first vehicle really that Matt bought after Three Doors Down made it.
Oh, wow.
And so anyhow, I got it. And then about a week or so later, I get a call. And they said, hey, Matt Roberts was going through his attic and he found some old paperwork, manuals and stuff for the car. And he thought that you might want them.
Wow.
And I was like, well, that's cool. You know, but what's really cool is that I thought in the back of my head, who would be nice enough to do that? Honestly,
right.
You know, you're going through old stuff in your attic, and then you come across this stuff, and who's going to make the effort? Who's going to be that great of a human to care enough to do something like that? So he reached out to me, and I said, yeah, give me my number. And so this was before I went to law school.
Okay.
And Matt and them was, you know, out touring and stuff like that.
Sure.
So I went out, I met him and everything and, you know, talked to him a couple times, after that, then I went to law school. They went off touring and so that's how we initially met. And then whenever I came back from law school, by the time I'd finished that, he had left the band.
Okay.
And so Matt was very entrepreneurial and was super, super smart with like stocks and things like that. And so him and my wife would share stock tips. They talk every day about stocks. He got up every morning. That was the first thing he did. He's looking at his stocks, seeing how they're doing. Super, super smart with it. And so anyhow, Matt also had, you know, various business dealings that he needed a lawyer for.
Okay.
And so a mutual friend of ours said, hey, you know, Joey's a lawyer now. And so, you know, anyhow, Matt called me and he said, hey, man, you know, let's grab lunch. And so we went and grabbed lunch. And he told me he wanted me to be his lawyer. And whatever came up, you know, for whatever came up.
Sure.
And his business ventures. So, we got to working together on a professional relationship and got to be, you know, extremely close friends. There where I, you know, just tremendous amount of love and trust between the two of us. And so we had talked about music and he really, he was developing a desire to make more music. And, so he wanted, you know, we talked about it and so, you know, he said, look, you know, why don't we start a record label together? Sure. That's easy. and so I put all the paperwork together and we started one, and we, you know, we'd made a decision that we were going to bring another close friend of ours in, who actually is my buddy I went to law school with. And so Matt had become friends with Joe as well. And so we were going to run it, and then we decided that we would bring in other friends and let them invest a little bit in an album, because he wanted just friends, you know, involved in it. And we wanted to start a label that would be artist friendly and, you know, artist first. We just wanted to make sure they were, you know, if they signed on with us, they were going to be very well taken care of, and it was going to be about them and their success rather than just labels. Which I'm sure you can appreciate.
Yes. My partner Brian and I have the same theology.
right. And who I also absolutely love, a guy with a tremendous heart, Brian.
Absolutely.
And so, you know, we just became really close friends. Matt wanted to, we were going to start with the very first music project being his.
Excellent.
So we compiled a band, we got in the studio, and, you know, and started making music.
It was
magical. We've got three songs. None of this has ever been released. Or completed.
Right.
And, you know, it's ultimately the perfect idea for me now at this point. It, you know, in the beginning, he was super fired up about it. And I asked him, I said, you know, how do you compare this work as an outsider looking in? And he was, you know, he said, I really think it's as good as anything I've ever done.
That's awesome.
And so he felt really strongly about it. We all were really excited with what was going on. He was adamant about me. He liked my ear. So he would send me something and say, I want you to ride around in your car and listen to this, and we'll talk about it tonight. So that was
awesome.
You know, I mean, I'd go in the studio and stuff, but that's what he wanted me to do. And so I was like, Matt, I'm not your level, but I'm sorry, you know, I'm not in music and stuff. I love music, but I'm just not. He said, but you are in your own way. And so,
sure.
We had a great working relationship, but a tremendous friendship. Man, Matt was as fine a human being as anyone could ever have in their life. You know, he cared about people. He loved the military.
Oh yeah.
He had a huge heart, huge heart.
You know, absolutely.
He loved people and was just a tremendous, tremendous person. And a great
Agreed.
Loss to us.
Agreed. Well, our condolences, of course, to you, your wife, and his nearest and dearest from all of us here at My Wright Stuff and me personally. And it must have been really difficult to carry on without him. Like, do you see that as continuing his legacy?
Man, that's something that I struggle with probably more than anything else, you know, that I can think of,
right.
Because I'm, you know, generally I'm the guy, somebody calls and boom, I've got an answer for it, an action plan. Let's get an action plan together. Let's do this and do that.
Sure.
With this, I just don't know. It's almost like I'm holding the reins. You know, and
right.
It's almost like I just don't want to, I want to do the right thing. And
right.
I've struggled with that. Something that is, I think that he would want done, that was very important. I mean, me and him, he would not approve anything without talking to me. And
right.
we sit down and discuss everything with an open mind. And so, you know, ideally, I want it released because it's obviously good, or he wouldn't have said what he said about it.
Right.
He was very good. I know that him and Brad wrote well together.
Yep.
He did a lot of writing,
yep.
as well as other members, of course. But I would love for it to be completed in a way that would honor him. And that would be through some of his friends or something, you know, in the industry, the other musicians.
Sure.
Maybe to step in and help complete it, because it's none of it is absolutely complete.
Okay.
There's always room to bring in more. So and change things. So as you well know. But it's, you know, it's, man, it's something I pray about. It's something I think a lot about. I want it to achieve the level of success that we started out wanting it to, and
right.
I want it to be, most importantly, I want it to be, you know, just a great tribute to him as a great writer and musician.
Absolutely.
And a great person. And a great person.
Right.
So,
well, if I can help in any way.
Yeah. That is something
I
definitely
love to
talk about and get some ideas, because you knew him on a professional level.
Yes, absolutely.
And so that's what I want, man.
Okay. Well, we'll talk about that off camera, and and we'll get it all going, and you know, we'll make what it's supposed to be. We'll make it into that, you know. And I think it'll be a wonderful thing coming from somebody like yourself with such a big heart, and myself as well. You know, let's just go for it. And we'll see what happens at the other end, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, now let's move on to the fast part of the show. Like, how'd you get into auto racing?
Man, you know, again, I have to step back a little bit. When I was in the Air Force,
okay,
when I would leave the base, there was a dealership there. It was a used car dealership, and they had a ton of 911s. I always loved 911s and wanted one my entire life. And I,
right,
you know, I always said, if I ever make any decent money, I'm going to buy one.
Okay.
And so I did, kind of as a graduation present to myself after I got out and made a little bit of money, I bought one. And I should have. Well, I say I should not have, but a buddy of mine invited me to go to the track with him. I had raced motocross whenever I was in the Air Force. I've always loved speed, high adrenaline stuff. You know, I was a warrant entry team when I was in law enforcement. So I'm a high adrenaline guy.
Okay.
And so I went to the track, and my first driving instructor there. So you go to the track, and basically they assign you a driving instructor that sits in the right-hand seat and navigates you around the track safely so you don't hurt yourself or others.
Right. Okay.
And on road courses, you know, because they have tons of twists and turns, and as you well know.
Yep.
So my first driving instructor was a Porsche guy, and and I had my 911. And yeah, Matt was a big car guy as well, and was
right.
Yeah. And so anyhow, that was a big thing for me. I got a 911. I was all happy with it and proud. And so I went to the track, and my first driving instructor is playing at Florida as well.
Okay. And that's good.
And so, he taught me a lot, and I just got addicted to it. And then my next driving instructor, you know, and mind you, I thought that I knew a good bit about driving because I'd been to pursuit schools and things like that in law enforcement.
Sure.
You know, and they do teach you a lot.
Right.
But man, it's a whole nother experience on a track. And so it was pretty intimidating. But then my next driving instructor, everybody knows him, Snooky Hill was his name. And he's still like, man, I still call him today and pick his brain for info and stuff. But
sure,
man, he took me to like another level with my driving. And it was like, you know, I still, my two driving instructors, Richard and Snooky, I call them today and say, you know, what about this? Can you look at this video and what can I do differently? And, you know, still pick their brain. So man, I kept getting better and better and better. And, you know, you get to one level and then, man, I want to get up to two,
right?
You know, and then
right.
I want to get up to three. And, you know, what starts out as learning a little bit about driving on the tracks quickly becomes an addiction almost, you know. Right. It's like, I had been out of law enforcement and hadn't done any high risk entries or anything like that in a while. And I was like, oh, wow, this kind of fills that adrenaline void in my life. And, super exciting, man. I've run with the Porsche Club of America and NASA, National Auto Sport Association. And so I worked my way up through the levels and then started competing. And then ultimately got competing in time trials and then getting my competition license for regular wheel-to-wheel. And I still, my same car, I use it when I do time trials, competing time trials. And
that's awesome.
That's we've modified it a whole lot, and but I've had a great time. Became an instructor so I could kind of give back. I'm not one of these people who just likes to grab and benefit from things.
Right.
Somebody tells me you want to give back, right?
Absolutely.
So went through that, and I've had vertigo issues, so I can't write, seat, instruct like my instructors did me.
Sure.
But what I do now, kind of my thing that I do at the track is just give pointers and help them and, you know, show them things on video, or I'll take them out for some laps.
Right.
And,
okay.
And show them, you know, how to do things. So, right. It's a fantastic sport, man. My it home really track is NOLA Motorsports Park in New Orleans.
Right.
All the folks there, man, are fantastic people. They, you know, I love Louisiana people anyhow.
Right.
And so I go over there and man, they treat me like one of their own. And
that's great.
Make which NAFA as an organization really though, is that way. I have not really, it's rare that you encounter, you know, a jerk. You know, everybody's helping everybody. In fact, I went down about a month ago. This year, they're going to have the national championships for NASA in Daytona.
Oh,
and
good.
So I told my buddies from New Orleans that was going with me. I said, look, why don't we register for one of the NASA Southeast and NASA Florida regions.
Sure.
Why don't we register for one of their events down at when they have one in Daytona and go down there and we'll sign up, you know, to compete, but let's just follow them around and try to, you know, learn the layout of the track and just kind of treat it as a practice weekend.
Sure.
You know, because it's a completely different course from what a normal road course is.
Exactly.
Right. Because you have the infield road course portion, but then on the outer edge, right,
you've got the fun.
The big NASCAR course.
That's right.
Yeah. And so
big bank curves and, you know, high bank.
Yeah, like 30 something degree high bank curves. You know, and I'm used to, you know, Louisiana's flat. So,
right,
so
right.
Louisiana's flat. Right. So I'm used to driving down the straights doing, you know, 140.
Right.
And instead of driving, you know, tilted sideways 30 something degrees, driving 160. I was like, let's just go down and learn the layout, learn the race line, and we'll watch.
Sure.
So we got down there and I met a guy that was in my same class. And I was kind of running behind him. And just to show, man, like the caliber of people, everybody like they're welcome you with open arms. But there's a guy actually in my class, and I've done this before at my home track to home folks, but a guy came up and he was running with me in the same class as me. And he said, man, he said, you know, you're doing great everywhere, but if you'll do this and do this, you'll drop some time.
Okay.
And I was like, well, cool, man. I appreciate that. And I had left my cool shirt. You know, we have a cooling system with vanes that run through the shirt to help keep you cool.
Exactly.
Well, I'm in Daytona, right? It's hot.
Always.
even now. So I left my cool shirt. Well, the same guy helped hook me up with getting another cool shirt and everything so I wouldn't be super hot in my car. Actually, man, the pointers he gave me allowed me to get third place and beat him.
That's great.
That's the camaraderie that you have, you know, at our level and our organization. You know,
sure.
It's just, man, it's just great folks.
Right.
And so, and then on Sunday, I got second place in my class.
Oh, wow. Congratulations.
And so it was, you know, everything just worked out great. But it's a phenomenal track, man. Daytona is so much fun.
Oh, that's actually where I learned to drive.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, my grandfather was friends with the owners back in the day. And so, you know, at 11 years old, I was driving his little Rolls Royce Ghost around the track.
Oh, sweet. Very nice.
You know, at 40 miles an hour when I'm 11. But still, it was kind of fun. But, you know, your record speaks for itself, and you have many accolades, including never had any on-track incidents with damage. And that in itself seems incredible because given that most drivers have had at least one big incident, exactly.
Right. Now, I've been off track, but I've fortunately, you know, have not had any contact, body contact damage. You know, I've messed up a wheel and suspension and stuff like that. But
oh, yeah.
I have not had any body contact so far. I'll try to avoid that. You know, it's like, man, I'll save that for the...
Right.
You know, for the dirt tracks or whatever, I guess.
Right, exactly. Save it for NASCAR. you know.
Yeah. So I've been, this is my fourth year of competition. And I'm competing in the national championships this year in Daytona, September 18th and 19th.
Excellent. Congratulations.
Be down there, come by and see. We'll be in the, I think they've assigned us the yellow spot in the yellow garages, they call them. They're yellow and blue. I'm supposed to be in the yellow garages. There'll be us down there. We'll have my sponsors are all down there.
That's great.
And so we'll have a great time. Got a lot of local friends that are coming, friends from all over the country that'll be down there. And
perfect.
And if Toby wants to come down, Toby gets VIP everything he wants.
All right. So, all right. I'll try to make it then. I like that VIP.
We're making a big push. I'm actually, next year we're looking to do something different, which is compete in a North America series. We're stepping up a notch is what we're looking to do. Our newest sponsor, Persist Communications.
Okay.
Committed to a race team next year, which me and a buddy of mine are in the process of forming. Your partner Brian is working with us on some multimedia stuff.
Excellent.
So that's what we're trying to do. And we've got some other sponsors that we're talking to, but we're looking to move up to a larger, you know, all across the country series next year. So that's what we're pushing for.
That's great.
So it was ironic. Like the first time, the first big commitment that we got was from Persist Communications. And it was, you know, a lawyer owns this company. His name's Ed Lake. He's a good friend of mine. And I was telling him about what I'm doing. He's been watching my videos, and he's kind of a New York guy that's living in Fort Lauderdale now. And he has this company that caters to lawyers. And he said, man, I've been watching your videos and stuff. And he's like, man, you're just killing it. What can we do? We want to be a part of that. And nice. Ed's like a super competitive guy too. And he knows how like competitive I am. So he's like, you know, and he's super, super, super driven.
Right.
And so he said, man, he said, we can do this. We can do this. And so he had us bring our cars down to Miami like 2 months ago.
Right. Okay.
For a convention, a trial lawyers convention down there. And we set them all up, and he had Danica Patrick come down, and she hung out and had dinner with us, and we had a big gathering, and they're fully committed to the race stuff. And, you know,
that's great.
They're great folks as well. So it'll be a fun team next year for sure.
Absolutely. I'm going to have to watch it closely, because it feels great to have a sponsor, right?
Yeah. And which I've had sponsors at the level that I've been at now.
Okay.
Like I've started out there, Porsche Mobile. Once I started competing, then people started paying more attention.
Right.
You know, it's like people don't pay attention much when you're in driver's education. They may see you moving up, you know, and notice that you're bringing your car in or whatever, you know, and they're like, you're doing something different in your car. What are you doing? And so I started competing, and my first year in competition, I won my class, and Porsche Mobile said, hey, we like what you're doing. What can we do? And they had just been bought out by a group out of Miami that had a bunch of car dealers. And so the former GM talked to me and said, what can we do to get involved? So set it up, and they really became my first real sponsor.
Oh, wow.
Paying sponsor. And then shortly after that, that GM was replaced with another GM and immediately called me up and said, hey, man, you know, I understand we've got this deal going with you. What can we do to help you win? You're winning. We want to keep you winning. What can we do? And so Porsche Mobile really, really, really stood up and helped guide me here. And honestly, man, no matter what level I get at, they will always be on my car somewhere.
Excellent.
Super guy. And then I'm in a group too called settlemycase.com.
Okay.
My partners in that are car guys. And so they've been, you know, a big help
financially, supporting, and, you know, in moral and otherwise encouragement and stuff, with the racing stuff. And, it's kind of become the theme of our Facebook page, Settle My Case.
That's great. That's great.
Yeah. So it's kind of the theme, because people don't want to hear from lawyers every time they turn on the TV or something like that. So
you're right.
It's really not about, not so much about the legal stuff as it is sharing positive vibes, you know, racing, things that people enjoy.
Exactly.
And, you know, and we just try to help people. It's not about, I'd say 95% of the calls we get, we're helping them find a lawyer somewhere in the country that they need. And we're not, you know, we're volunteering that time. We're not making money off of that.
Right.
And it's all about helping and just trying to make the world a better place.
That's what it's all about for me too, you know?
Yeah.
So like with the sponsor stuff, do you feel pressure at all, or does it inspire you?
Man, I don't think anybody can put more pressure on myself than I do.
And you, right.
It's like, yeah. Cause man, I know you can't win every time, right? Sure. If you're winning every time, it's really boring. Not challenging enough.
Yeah. And, just ask Lewis Hamilton.
So I just keep, you have to keep raising the bar. And, that's what I've done, you know, and the way the program set up with the high performance driver's education is you start out at level one, then you have to meet certain criteria before you can go to two, then to three, then to four, then into competition. And so once you're in competition, you just raise your competition, right? Your expectations. So if you're winning in your class, and I've actually done this, I've registered for the class higher before.
Okay.
Which is they base the classes off of horsepower to weight ratio, right?
Okay.
So if I'm running TT3 and I don't have enough cars or something in my class for that weekend,
right,
I'll register my car in TT2 with faster cars.
Okay.
And compete against them just to have more of a challenge.
Right.
And that's kind of, we're just at a step now, me and my buddy William Barnes, who we're going to be a race team together. Man, we're just at that point where we want to step up on a bigger scale in a North America series, more so than a regional series.
That's awesome. I want to jump in there with you.
Yeah, we're ready, man. Come with us, man. Come with us. We'd love to have you.
I want to jump in the car too. We'll do some endurance racing, man.
Yeah. Well, that's, you know, there's a couple of different series that we're looking at, and, you know, one of them is endurance racing. And if we go that route, we will be picking up another driver.
Excellent.
And, we just haven't decided. Yeah, it's financing and what the sponsors want, possibly.
Exactly.
It's a lot of money. It's a whole lot of money. And you have to have sponsors.
Oh, yeah.
I say sponsors because that's what everybody knows them as. I don't treat sponsors like sponsors. I treat them like partners. I promote them. They help us. And I promote them. So we're selective really about who we bring on board and these partnerships.
And I don't blame you.
Yeah, you've got I have a reputation that I have uphold. And I don't want somebody just coming up and giving me money and me not benefiting them.
Absolutely.
So, but at the same time, I can't go out and promote them and benefit them if I can't feel like good about what they're doing.
Yeah,
right.
Oh, absolutely.
So I try to learn as much as I can about the company, and then we partner up and work, win races.
That's perfect.
One thing that the sponsors like is they like trophies.
That's right.
And so I get them. I get my sponsors every year. The major sponsors get a duplicate of the championship trophy, which I've got three championships in my class, the 3 years I competed in, one overall champion.
Right.
And so like Porsche Mobile has those and they love them in their showroom. Their customers like seeing them. And there's a lot of other things we do too. Like for example, Persist Communications is my new sponsor.
Right.
they want to take some of their customers out for potlatch. So we're exploring right. the possibility of doing a private track day rental.
Oh, yeah. New Orleans.
And you know, if Danica's available, I think she's going to come down. If she's not, then, you know, I guess me and William will do it. But we'll take, you know, we'll take people out for a hot
I'll call Johnny O'Connell for you.
Yeah. All right.
All right.
That'd be great.
I can do that for you.
Yeah. Well, we definitely want some good, you know, some good folks there and to take people out and safely take them out for some laughs. Cause man, you know, for the people that has never been in a track car on a road course and sit in the passenger seat, I've had friends of mine tell me that they've never been on a roller coaster that fun.
That's right. That's right.
And it's a lot of fun. It's more fun if you don't have issues with motion sickness.
Right.
And for those that do have any issues, well, I tell, if someone's going to ride with me the next day, I'll say, you know, I tell them, leave your ego at home. I don't want you being a tough guy, you know, and us as men, we have to be told that sometimes. Look, leave your ego at home. Don't be a tough guy. If you start getting sick, tell me. The purpose is not to make you sick. It's for you to have a good time.
Exactly.
Right? And I want you to remember it. So you'll love the sport even more and you'll come back.
That's right.
And enjoy it and appreciate what the guys are doing out there on the field. You know, because you watch football and you're like, Tom Brady throws a pass. And it's like, I look pretty easy, right?
Sure.
It's not. It's not easy. It's not easy at all.
And, yeah, you just try it once. Go for it.
Yeah. So when you come out and you ride for some hot laps, you really get an appreciation.
Oh, yeah.
For what it's about. Because even when I take people out, you know, I'm going to go at probably 90% of the pace, maybe 95% if somebody's a daredevil, you know, and they really want to go a little bit. But I'm in no way going to get out there and do anything that is going to risk, you know, causing them harm. I'm not going to push 100% with a guest in the car.
No.
But I do, but they'll think, even if you're going 80% of your normal pace, they will think that they're about to crash at any second.
That's right.
I know because I thought that, and I thought I knew a good bit about driving.
Well, that's because you're not in control as the passenger. You're not in control as a passenger, right? So, you know, when I'm a passenger, I get a little freaked out sometimes when somebody's like going around a corner too fast or, you know, coming too close or too much braking or, you know, whatever. And, you know, you just feel those G-forces. It's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. You know, would I have done that? Is that what it feels like when I drive too?
Absolutely. So I tell them, I had some good friends I grew up with, and I told them, I said, look, guys, leave your egos at home.
That's right.
Don't drink anything tonight before you come to the track.
Oh, no.
We've been out on these boats out in the Gulf and all this sort of stuff. Never got car sick. And I said, guys, I'm telling you,
right.
I want you to have fun. I don't want you to get sick. It's no fun being sick.
Absolutely.
Some people listen, some people don't. So
that's right. Those are the ones you make up. They clean up the car afterwards.
Yeah, I haven't had anybody get sick in the car because I'll get off the track before that. But
that's good.
They generally wait until they're feeling too bad to really recover from it before they say anything.
Right, right.
Man, you know, and that's just not what I want. I want them to have a great time. And so it's a lot of fun. That's my way of giving back to the sport is introducing new people that are interested.
Oh, I love it, dude. That's so good. So it doesn't sound like you have any plans for slowing down. And, you know, it sounds like you just have plans to keep on going forward. So is there anything that you want the world to know about Joey Dumas and his life experiences? And where can we find you for more info?
Well, you can reach out through my friend Toby Wright. I'm just kidding.
Hey, that's me.
settlemycase.com is
okay.
Will give you a good bit of insight about me. You know, I tell everybody I'm a small town Citronelle boy that has worked exceptionally hard and had to get to where I'm at. But I'm still a small town Citronelle boy. You know, I mean, I've got a lot of important friends, and but I'm just not one of them. You know, I'm a down to earth guy.
You know, we're going to have to bring out the checkered flag for this episode.
Yeah.
And it looks as though we both finished on the podium, dude.
Well, it's, you know, it's, I am passionate about my work and the things that I get involved in. And it is really, really bad stuff a lot of times, professionally. Oh, yeah. But, the upside is, we're making a difference.
Excellent.
And I, you know, we have a lot of good people in society that become addicts, man. And it's, we got to do something to help them, because they're not bad people. We've got to change that stigma.
Right.
Where there's plenty of people that have become addicts recreationally, but a lot of them, you know, it's as simple as getting in a car wreck or getting hurt on the job or something like that.
And, right.
You know, I've seen it in my profession. I know you have as well.
That's right.
Some of our mutual friends and folks that you've worked with, and they're all good people. You know this as well or better than I do.
Absolutely.
A lot of them are really good people, man. That either made bad decisions, like we all have, or for whatever, you know, legitimate medical reasons,
right?
Have become that way. But they're human, and they have hearts, and they love just like we do.
That's right. And that's what we have to all be very cognizant of.
That's exactly right. That's right. We're all in this together, man.
That's right. And that's a great way to leave it, because this has been a very informative and fun episode, Joey. Thank you. I loved all the stories and learning about you and your race team and legal side and the music and the music label and all the legal stuff. And it's great, man. Thank you for your service and in the service. And, but I want to thank Joey for taking the time to be part of this episode of My Wright Stuff. And thank you to our sponsor, Taummhoms, which is a natural sleep and sound healing portal, helping people globally to get to sleep faster and stay asleep longer. You can find this piece of gold at www.taummhoms.com. That's TAUMMHOMS.com. But most of all, a big thank you to all who stream, download, watch, and support My Wright Stuff. And please keep spreading the word. Also, we have a merch store that you can pick up some snazzy merch for those bodies. And don't forget to tag us in any photos with our merch so we can give you a live shout out at MyWrightStuff.com. So let's just show you a little bit of this here. Some sample merch here. We got this wonderful My Wright Stuff champion hoodie. This one comes in black. It's snuggly and all that kind of good stuff. Keep you warm on those times when you need to be warm. And I want to thank our whole My Wright Stuff crew for making this podcast possible every week. It's been another exciting episode of My Wright Stuff. And be sure to tune in next week and every week for yet another adventurous episode. Please be sure to subscribe on YouTube so you never miss an episode. And I hear it also gives you like 10 years good luck to hit the bell. All right. Well, I'm your host, Toby Wright. And remember to listen loud, play hard, and keep reaching for your dreams. Thank you again, Joey, and good night.
Thank you.
Troubled mind. I left my body lying somewhere in the sands of time. But I watched the world flip to the dark side of the moon. I feel there's nothing I can do. Yeah. I watched the world flip to the dark side of the moon. After all I knew it had to be something to do with you. I really don't mind what happens now and then, as long as you'll be my friend at the end.
Toby, yep. Before we go, I got to tell you something that's really, really, really cool about Persist. You know, obviously on the track, we're concerned about time, you know,
right.
Faster laps, shorter right. time. Well, Ed has this system that he uses in his law firm, and he's actually using it in a bunch of law firms around the country.
Okay.
But it's not limited just to law firms. It's just all in how it's configured, right? So before he went to law school, you know, he went kind of later in life like I did.
Right.
Before that, he was involved in phone systems and stuff. So what okay. he does is we both work in what's called mass torts, mass actions. So you have tons of clients, you know, like a
okay.
car dealership or a air conditioning company or something like that would have. So
right.
as you can imagine, when you're trying to contact all your clients, right, you spend a whole lot of time dialing digits and
oh, heck yeah.
you're sitting there waiting and waiting and waiting. Hey, Ms. Smith, you know, leaving a voice message, things
sure.
like that, waiting on them to call back. Well, that ties up a ton of resources.
Oh,
so Ed has streamlined that. So what you do is his system is actually working in the background, contacting people in the method that they've requested, whether it's by text or phone or whatever. So
oh, cool.
your employees are not sitting around on the phone pushing buttons. They're essentially waiting just for the client to call. And so when the client calls, they talk to that client, and then boom, immediately they're talking to another client. So there's not this lag there of back and forth with dialing and waiting and, you know, sitting there waiting for the phone to ring 10 times. All of that
right.
takes time. So if you condense the actual work hours there, you condense it down
right.
into real working hours and cut out all the fluff, right?
Okay.
Then you are so much more efficient. And you're saving time, you're saving money. That savings cuts down on you know, expenses to the company itself, law firm,
right.
air conditioning company, car dealership,
right.
whatever, service industry. That's those savings can be passed on ultimately to the customer. So it makes the whole system just so much more efficient. And
yeah, it sounds like
I have a double dose of like this efficiency thing because
right.
at work in my profession in the law firm, you want to save, yeah, you want to be efficient at what you do. And,
of course.
And then on the track, every little bit of time that you can save in each curve or, you know, or getting on the throttle a little bit faster or cutting
right.
a little bit tighter, you know, you want to save the time. You want to be on the brakes and
that's
then
right.
boom, back going again. And that's exactly what this Persist system does. Got a little tongue tied there. Exactly what this Persist system does is it cuts out all those corners that are wasted. The time when you're on the brake, you know, you're on the brake and on the track and you're back on the gas as quickly as you can. You don't want to be on the brake and then lifting and then you're coasting. That
right,
coasting
exactly.
is wasting time. You
yep.
need to be from one thing onto the other as quickly as you can.
Right.
And that's
Full
exactly
out.
What Persist does.
Right. So they have like a lot of less task and more talk action going on, right?
Exactly. Exactly.
That's killer. Because that's what you do in the race
time.
Car too.
Time is money. Time is money. You know, I got to put
right.
everything into the race car kind of scenario.
Sure. Sure. I like to think that way too. It's just logical
yes.
to me.
Absolutely. It makes sense.
That's right. That's right.
So anyhow, I appreciate you letting me throw that in there, you know, because I know you have a wide variety of listeners.
Right,
but
right.
It saves money, man. It saves money. And it makes a whole lot of sense.
That's awesome. And I'm sure a bunch of our listeners will be very interested.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So
awesome.
There you go.
Well, thank you very much. And thank you, Persist. Subscribe to our My Wright Stuff podcast channel and send your contact info to media@mywrightstuff.com to be entered in the raffle for the special edition t-shirt.
Thank you for watching My Wright Stuff. This episode was brought to you by